Welcome to CivilNet. My guest today is Gevorg Ter-Gabrielyan, who is the executive director of the Eurasia Partnership Foundation, Armenia, and who has, in both his personal and professional capacities over several years, certainly over a decade, been involved in cross-border issues, conflict resolution issues. I'm tempted to even say peace issues, although I'm not sure we do a lot of that in this region. Gevorg, thank you for joining us.
Hi, you're welcome. Thank you for inviting me.
Gevorg, the immediate reason for the invitation was your interview in the Caucasus edition, where you talk about things that we don't talk about that much anymore. Certainly in Armenia we don't, and I don't know that we ever did in Azerbaijan, and so here we are. You were talking about peace, about what it would take to get to peace, about the necessary platforms for discussions about peace. Why now are we talking about this? Is it, you know, Azerbaijani elections are coming up and that gives us a cover, an excuse to talk about this?
Well, no, I think there is no now for this type of conversation, because I talk about this, as you said, for over a decade or longer, and there is a community which maybe doesn't get to the media that much.
Why?
I think they don't do a good PR. So I sent my publication to a lot of people, and you in particular. That's why it became known. Whereas that Caucasus edition thing, it exists for more than 3 years probably now. And there are so many other such activities. They just don't add up to a quality change. That's another problem that I'm talking about also in that interview.
In that interview, you talk about the fact that over this, and I don't even know how long to say, should we say over this nearly two decades, should we say from the ceasefire forward?
Since 93, I would say.
Okay, so for two decades then, since the end of the military conflict, more or less, you say there have been thousands of people involved at this track two level diplomacy, people to people diplomacy. That many.
Yes, and if we count since the times of the conflict, then it probably even more than just 1,000. I would say a few thousands. Of course, nobody has counted.
Sure.
But right now, a colleague organization is doing a project on bringing together on the web the projects which addressed conflict, civil society projects, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Georgia, Abkhazia, all Caucasus, etc. And they have gathered already about 150 cases, and they are only looking within the last 5 years. So if you take about a third of that connected with Armenia, Azerbaijan, you can see that every project, it's about meetings, essentially. Most of the projects are about meetings. Some projects in recent times are about virtual meetings more than person-to-person meetings, but essentially the projects are about meetings. So they have been indeed thousands of people who from both sides who met each other over these years.
And they are public sector, NGO community?
Well, most of them have been non-governmental, but of course if we don't count the diplomats and all of the generations and all of the groups of the foreign office employees who met because they had to meet, or other ministry employees who are meeting within the European Eastern Partnership setting, etc.
No, us, the people from the countries.
It's professionals, it's NGO, it's things like that, teachers,
and is there
doctors.
Continuity, do you think?
No. The thing is, that's another element, that quantities are large, but donors usually don't fund long-term, large-scale, strategic investment in that direction. They usually fund different organizations for smaller scale projects. So they fund many, but it's like a dispersed opportunity.
As a result, we have what we have. We have pockets of individuals engaged in talking to each other. And then we have an environment where not only do we not publicly really talk about peace and what it would take to get there and how much I'm willing to give to get there, we also really have a public environment where peace is almost assumed impossible. Is that fair?
Well, I want to look, there are two different environments. So I'm speaking about the Armenian environment, if you wish, because in Azerbaijan it's different. The thing is, not just that peace is impossible. I think if you ask people in Nagorno-Karabakh, they will say peace is there already for 20 years. That's not the point. The point is the dual discourse, the double discourse that exists, exactly as it was in the Soviet times, when there was the official ideology and the reality. We have the same situation here for 20 years, because according to the official ideology, we, the Armenian side, are putting ourselves under a huge strain in order to defend our national values. I mean, the official Armenian ideology, because that ideology contradicts the state ideology in general of the majority of states which exist, because they are for territorial integrity the way they understand it. In our context, that means Karabakh doesn't belong to Armenia or is not independent. So it creates a double-speak situation, because the entire relationship with the international community that we build is based on respecting all of the international assumptions, principles, etc. But in our official ideology, and in a justified way, we are having a totally different picture of the world. And so these two approaches clash, and I think they create problems inside our souls, in addition to policy problems and everything.
Except that when we do diplomacy right, when we do public discourse about this conflict right, we have in the past succeeded in saying that, look, yes, territorial integrity for Azerbaijan, but Qarabakh was never a part of independent Azerbaijan. And so as far as Qarabakh goes, that's a whole different set of rules. They followed the rules. They followed the rules for secession and all of that. So we have given ourselves, the international community, even Azerbaijan, a way out if we want peace and we want to go there.
Yes, and even now, not only in the past. In the past, of course, there were also diplomatic successes, like the participation of the Karabakhi side in the ceasefire agreement. But it's all, unfortunately, in the past. Even today, most of us, those who are thinking about these things and trying to do something about them, in their arguments with the international community, they use this approach, this argumentation. Moreover, if we visit some of the, I don't want to mention the names, but some of the international offices here in Armenia, we can see on their walls the maps where Nagorno-Karabakh is a part of Armenian territory, because it's a convenient, very detailed map, and they don't care about political correctness from their perspective. Okay, so Armenian side does all that work, but there is still this huge gap because, as I said, all of the support for such activities is spread, it's not concentrated. There's also another gap. I kind of deviated talking about it, because the other gap is the fact that it's uncomfortable to live with an enemy. I don't want to be hated. I don't like to have enemies. Especially if I don't feel, if they want something from me, I don't want anything from them anymore. I got it, what I wanted. So this feeling of, you know, every day turning on the media and listening that another anti-Armenian protest took place and stuff like that, I think this is creating a frustration. And that's why, because of those two motivations that I mentioned, we should think about building our peace strategy, not just declaring the conflict is over, not just, you know, doing the diplomatic work we do within the Minsk group, which should be done according to a certain rules, but having a national consensus, including the diaspora, on what is it, how do we see the future of Armenia in this region in a peaceful coexistence with Azerbaijan? And even more difficult, what can we do while the situation is quite blocked and while the other side is much less constructive? Everybody recognizes that. What can we do to induce the other side to change their position? It's like courting a woman who doesn't want love you, who doesn't want to see
not
you,
interested.
Who hates you. So what can we do to resolve that very peculiar situation?
One of the things that you say in your interview is that we live in a region, and we always say we live in a problematic region and all of that, but beyond that, what you've said is that we live in a region where there are all sorts of pairs of long-term acrimony, at the very least. I'm not saying enmity, I'm saying acrimony. Lots of pairs, you know, Georgian, Abkhaz, and on and on. And so we almost take it for granted that that's how this region's supposed to be.
Yeah, but that wasn't so 15, 20 years ago. And until today, some of the people who were had the spread existence, the families that, for instance, lived in Patigorsk and in Yerevan, and some of them also in Suhumi, they at least now they can, with difficulties, but get from Yerevan to Pyatigorsk, passing two borders, not anymore to Suhumi unless via Sochi, but then they are banned from Tbilisi. So, you know, that wasn't like that. This was, Caucasus was a free and quite flourishing region in the Soviet times, and the strength of the movement for independence was determined by the fact that it had accumulated some resource, and North Caucasus was living peacefully with South Caucasus, and the Armenians were living in their band, like my ancestors, for instance, and I didn't have any relatives already in the 20th century there, but Armenians were living in Dagestan until 1988, in southern part of Dagestan, and they are now gone now. So it was a very different situation. This is not as it should be. This is not the fait accompli or the, you know, the order of things.
If you dig, scratch a little bit in the popular discourse in certainly our country, and I would say even probably in the region, once you get past the requisite extreme nationalist lines, you do get down to a level where many people, perhaps most, I don't know, are willing to say that, look, we do have red lines to cross. You know, Qarabağ's sovereignty and self-determination are not negotiable. But there are things that we should be able to do together as peoples, as countries, in order to get past this absurd situation. Does that discussion have any value when we're looking at two countries where bottom-up doesn't really work, where policies aren't determined bottom-up? Oh,
very good and difficult question indeed. We have too many challenges that we face simultaneously. I think they should go, it's like the egg and the chicken kind of thing. I think this democratization agenda and the peace agenda, sorry for using these kind of stereotypical,
but they're legit,
battered words, but they both should go together. There is no way around that. And moreover, there is a merit to the argument which says that those who don't want to democratize have an interest in also keeping the conflict alive and vice versa. So I don't want to get deep into that argument, but there is sometimes there is a very clear connection between the two. So in very general terms, that's that. We should work on both front lines simultaneously.
I don't want to talk about Azerbaijani politics, except since you put it in that way in terms of these two agendas or lobbies. What I keep hearing from those who know Azerbaijan well domestically is that there are two very tiny lobbies, both democratization and peace, in Azerbaijan, and they don't like each other. Because one thinks that the other one is
exactly
stepping on its toes.
Yes. So honestly, if I may, I don't very much trust the peace group there. I do trust the democratization, the democracy group. And I do prefer, because we're all Asian, not Asian, but like Eastern people, you know, we're very good with making a smile and saying that, yeah, we want peace with you guys, everything was fine.
So, we haven't been doing that lately.
Well, there is
but
this small group,
and
often sincerely, but sometimes also hypocritically, they say that. But the democratization group, they have genuine common interests with our democratizers. Also, they will have nationalist agenda for two reasons. One, it's an accompanying element, look at the Saakashvili story, an accompanying element for democratization reform to be quite nationalist. Two, because many reasons. Two, because they lost the war. Three, because they cannot fight on two fronts. So in order, because they are very challenged in their society, so in order to have at least some kind of a success, they should declare that they are on the same average line of nationalism as the others. So there are many reasons for that. But in terms of the big strategic alliance, we are with them, unless they turn to be like Young Turks. But that's one mistake Armenians did once. Let's not repeat it another time.
It's a fantastic topic, fascinating conversation, and really we should be having more of it and more publicly without the black and whites. Without the black and whites, more of these grays so that we can move past this absurd situation.
I agree, and thank you for letting me to publicize this topic, which I think is very interesting. Just one more, a little bit of an advertising line. We're going to run a school on conflict transformation and peace building.
This is the Eurasia Partnership
Foundation. Yeah, Eurasia Partnership Foundation. We'll send out applications to a lot of youth in Armenia. It will be in Armenian, of course. in September, and we're looking forward to some recruitees who can then continue on discussing this.
And I've been invited to speak, so I thank you.
Okay.
thank you, Gevorg Ter-Gabrielyan. Gevorg Ter-Gabrielyan is executive director of the Eurasia Partnership Foundation in Armenia, and we've been speaking about peace. Thank you for following us on CivilNet.